question and answers. To handle this session, we have an eminent speaker, none other than Mr. Vinayak Hegde. May I request CA Lokesh to escort the speaker onto the dais and welcome in pocket. Thank you. I take this opportunity to give a brief introduction of Vinayak Hegde. Very brief. He has completed his articleship in Hegde and Associates. After qualifying, he is qualified in 2011. Since then, he is practicing in the area of indirect taxes and partner in Vishnodaya & Co. With this brief introduction, I welcome you all once again. I present before Vinayak Hegde. Over to you.
Branch of ICAI for giving me this opportunity to share few thoughts on GST. The topic given to me is GST questions and answers. So when we say GST questions and answers, it is we have so many questions. We are not sure for how many questions we have the answers. I have listed out few questions which I thought are relevant considering that we are filing the annual return and reconciliation statement. And I have made my effort to answer those questions to the best of my knowledge. And of course, you may have a different view which we can definitely share when it comes to the respective questions. To start with, I have taken up the issue of discounts. What is the impact of GST on the discounts? Now, you might have come across with one recent circular on discounts that was issued by the CBIC. In light of that circular, I have framed certain questions. Now, before I get into the questions or the specific issues what is clarified by the circular, let us understand brief about the provisions relating to the discount. Now, first thing is that the section 15 of the GST Act covers the valuation related provisions. The section 15.3 provides that discounts before or at the time of supply shall be given as a reduction from the value. That is, at the time of supply or before the supply if any discount is given and such discount is disclosed specifically in the invoice, then the tax shall be paid on the net value. That is the first provision. The second thing is related to the post-sale discounts. If any discount is given after the supply takes place and then whether it is allowed as a reduction, that is a question. Now, if you look at it, the provisions clear, what it says is the discount which is given post-sale is allowed as a reduction from the taxable value if it is pre-agreed. That means before the supply takes place, the discount related quantum or the mode in which the discount given should be pre-agreed. If the discount is not pre-agreed, it is a afterthought after the supply, such discount is not allowed as a reduction from the taxable value. Now the second requirement is that input credit in proportionate to the discount what is given should be reversed by the recipient. The third requirement is that the discount what is given should be tracked to the original supply invoice. So if these requirements are met, then the taxable value whatever is there from that amount, the discount amount given post sale shall be reduced. Now what is the mode of giving the discount is by way of credit note. So you can give a credit note to the extent of the discount amount and file in the GSTR1. So we upload the discount by giving a credit note with giving reference to the original tax invoice in the GST portal. Based on that, the recipient has to reverse his input tax credit. In such case, for the supplier, the value of the discount shall be considered as reduction. Now, there are various kind of discounts that could be there. Now, initially the department gave one clarification by circular number 92 of 2019. In that among various discounts, the two discounts that was addressed was volume discount and secondary discount. Now, volume discounts are what? Now, if there is a supply happens by a, let us say, brand owner of a garment sector to the dealers, he might say that if you buy X number of quantity in a year, I will give you additional 1% or 2% discount. So, this is kind of a volume discount. Now, what the clarification says is, if such volume discount is pre-agreed, that is before the sale supply takes place, if it is agreed and other conditions are met, then on such discount, the brand owner or the supplier can give a credit note and he can claim a reduction. The second thing is the secondary discount. That means the discounts that are given post sale which are not pre-agreed. These are maybe for increasing the sales or for whatever reasons, additionally some discount is given and it is not pre-agreed. In such case, what the clarification says is the supplier has to give a commercial credit note. Commercial credit note can be given and there is no reduction from the taxable value will be done for the purpose of GST. In other words, the GST will be paid on the gross amount. Commercial credit note is given for the knocking of the commercial transaction. And this is a clarification given in March 2019. Thereafter, in June 2019, another set of clarification issued by the CBIC. So this clarification has created lot of confusions. If we look at it, what are all the points that the circular clarified? I have listed out. First thing is post-sale discount given without any obligation from the dealer. The second set of clarification covers discount in the form of incentive. Then discount to reimburse the additional special discount given by the dealer, or in other words, it can be called as margin reimbursement. Then the third one is implication in case of post-sale discount not reduced from the value of supply in terms of section 15(3). So these are all the four kind of transactions with the circular clarified. Now first clarification is simple. Post-sale discount given without any obligation from a dealer. That means it is kind of a normal volume discount or a target discount which is given after the sale, which meets the requirement of the provisions of section 15(3). Then what circular says is that is simple credit note shall be given by the supplier and he shall reduce his tax liability and the recipient has to reverse the input tax credit. So as far as this point is concerned, I think everybody is clear on this, right? It is a normal post-sale discount. Now the second clarification comes in the form of discount given with kind of a obligation from the dealer. Like the supplier is giving a credit discount for the purpose that the dealer has to undertake certain special sales drive, or there is some other marketing activity he has to take, then he shall be given a discount. So there what the clarification says is, it is a kind of a, you know, there is a quid pro quo. That means I will give a discount, you do certain activity in return. So in such case, what the clarification says is there is a two supply involved. That is supply of goods by the brand owner or supplier to the dealer, and from dealer in the form of a marketing or a special advertisement or different kind of a service to the supplier of the goods. So the clarification is making it as a two transaction happening at a time. So for that, what the provisions clarification says is, for the supply of goods, the supplier will raise normal tax invoice and he will charge applicable GST. On the services what is done by the dealer to the supplier, he has to raise a tax invoice with applicable GST. So that tax invoice, whatever GST charged, would be an input tax for the supplier. And this transaction shall not be routed through credit note is what the clarification is telling. Clear? Now moving to the next clarification. Special discount reimbursement. what the circular says is, now there is a case where the dealer is giving special additional discount to the customer. Let us take a simple case. Now, like for example, you go buy a shirt. There is a discount announced on that. The MRP, let us say 1000 rupees. On that, now the dealer is announcing saying that there is an additional discount of 10%. So you come and buy. So now what happens? That 10% discount is given by dealer to the end customer. But that discount is not absorbed by him. That discount he is getting reimbursed from the brand owner. The brand owner is specifically saying that to augment the sales, or maybe because there is a end of the season sales, or there is to liquidate the stock, he says that you give additional discount to the customers. In such case, what the clarification says is, in the hands of the dealer, for the sale of one particular product, the consideration is coming from two ends. That is, the one first consideration is coming from the end customer directly, where he is paying 90% of the value, and plus GST you would pay. The remaining additional 10% discount what is given, that is coming from the supplier of the goods in the form of a credit note or in the form of a discount. So therefore, in the hands of the dealer, the value which is subjected to tax is the full amount, and on that he has to pay GST is what is the clarification is saying. So do you feel it is logical?
Getting full MRP, so this, I get that department.
Yeah, that is the department's view.
It seems to be against the unjust enrichment.
In the sense?
Because the benefit will get passed to the ultimate customer.
Ultimate customer is not getting any benefit. We can look at the same transaction in other way also. Like for example, when the dealer sells the goods for 90% of the price, that is after giving the 10% discount, we can also say that the supplier has reduced his purchase, his selling price itself by 10%. So therefore, how it can be a consideration in the hands of the dealer? His purchase price is getting reduced. So if the credit note is given with GST compliant, he would reverse the input tax credit. So then that ends the matter. But what is the logic in saying that the dealer has to pay full tax on the gross amount rather than allowing the credit note as a deduction? So that is something which is, this circular is creating lot of issues. Now, if you look at it, this kind of scenarios could be there in many cases. Like you take, for example, automobile industry. So there could be various kind of this kind of reimbursement by the auto manufacturer to the dealers. Like one more example that I could think of is exchange bonus. That if somebody is coming to an auto dealer of Maruti and he is exchanging Maruti car, then that there is a exchange or loyalty bonus, something that the car manufacturer will announce, so that the dealer will give it to the customer, and the dealer gets that reimbursed from the auto manufacturer. So now if we go by the circular what is issued, so then on the entire amount, even without claiming the reduction for that exchange bonus, the tax has to be paid. So this is the implication that is created by the circular clarification. Now whether it is right or wrong, that is something we have to wait and see. Whether the department will come out with some different clarification or somebody will challenge before the court, that is something which we have to wait and see. Now another clarification that has come in the same circular is that, now suppose in case there is a discount given which is not pre-agreed, that is a post-sale discount which is not pre-agreed. Now in this case, because of the provisions, the supplier of goods will not be able to claim reduction from his taxable value. So that amount will have to be paid on the, in the sense, the on the gross amount GST would have been paid. Now what the circular clarifies is, the supplier can give a commercial credit note, and the recipient of the credit note, that is the dealer, he need not reverse input tax credit provided he has paid full GST to the supplier. Now, why this the clarification has got some relevance? Now, you are aware that in case of GST, the supplier has to pay to the wherever he has taken the input tax credit, he has to make the payment within 180 days from the invoice date. If he has not done the payment, then he has to reverse the input tax credit. So that is the provision. Now, in this case, what is happening? The supplier has the vendor has given a tax invoice with GST, and afterwards he has given a commercial credit note. So I am not paying him to the extent of the amount involved in the commercial credit note. So then there is always a possibility that the department may come and say that you have not paid the full amount, so therefore you reverse the proportionate input tax credit also. So these things are happening even in service tax also, if you have come across. In some cases, the service tax authorities during the audit say that payment is not made within 180 days, so you have to reverse the input tax credit. Similarly, in the GST also. Now, what the circular is saying, whenever such kind of commercial credit note is coming, if the GST is paid fully, that means if originally the price, billing price was 100 rupees plus 18 rupees tax, 118, afterwards there is a 10% discount, and after the discount also, if the tax paid to the supplier is full, that means 100 rupees basic value, 10% discount, that comes to 90 rupees, but the tax paid to the supplier is 18 only. In such case, the circular says that the full credit can be availed. Since the supplier has not claimed any benefit, the recipient can avail full credit. There is no need to reverse any input tax credit. So this is a clarification. Now we can look at applying the same clarification in certain other areas also. Like for example, if you take a construction industry, that retention amount. Now, whenever there is a construction industry, generally there will be a retention amount which the builder or the contractor will withheld, saying that until the work is completed, if there is any damages, I would like to recoup it. So there what happens, if the retention amount is computed on the gross amount, so then what happens is the full tax as well as invoice value is not paid to the vendor within 180 days. So then there is a scope for asking the reversal of the input tax credit. If in such case, if the retention amount is calculated only on the basic value, but the tax is paid fully itself in the initial stage, then we can take shelter under the circular and say that full input tax credit is eligible. Any doubts on the discounts? We'll move further. The next question is whether the subcontractor is liable for 12% GST or 18% GST in case of affordable housing. You might be aware that recently for the real estate sector, the government came out with a different kind of rate of tax, in the sense the reduced rate of tax. For affordable housing, they announced that there is a 1% GST on the sale of flats. Similarly, in the sale notification, there is one entry is given wherein for the works contract, composite supply contracts, the rate of tax is 12% for the contractor who is constructing affordable housing project, provided the builder or the promoter has not opted to continue in the old scheme. That means he is opted for 1%, the builder or the promoter. In such case, the contractor can go for the 12% rate. Now the question here is whether the subcontractor also can go for 12% rate or he has to charge 18%. Can he go for 12% or 18%? Now, if you look at the provision, one is the entry which talks about the rate of tax applicability, and there are certain conditions. If we look at the provisions which gives the benefit of 12%, it only says that the composite supply in the form of works contract for the construction of affordable housing. It does not talk about whether the main contractor is eligible or subcontractor is eligible or subcontractor is ineligible. No such point is given. If we go based on the plain reading of it, we could draw an interpretation saying that even the subcontractor can go for 12%. However, there is one hitch which we noticed. In the proviso, that is in the conditions part, there is one word used, the recipient of the service, that is promoter. There it is used in the context of if the project turns out to be non-affordable, then the promoter has to pay the differential tax. So this proviso could be interpreted in both ways, saying that if the subcontractor charges 12%, then the differential tax liability lies on the promoter. Or we can say that since it says that the promoter is the recipient, in case of subcontractor there is no direct agreement with the promoter, so he shall have to continue for the 18%. So this is something which could create litigation. So either we can approach for the advance ruling or the subcontractor can go for the 18%. Now the another one issue that come up is whether the back office support services fall within the scope of intermediary. Now the issue of intermediary is something which is a lot of subject matter of litigation nowadays. Intermediary concept as such you are aware, right? The intermediary is a person who facilitates the supply of goods or services between two or more parties, and he does not provide that service on his own account. In case of intermediary, what happens is, let us say intermediary is located in Bangalore and he is providing marketing services to a customer located in US for which he earns commission. The commission is earned in foreign currency. Now our general understanding is that whenever we provide service to a person outside India and earn the consideration in foreign currency, it amounts to export of service. But this intermediary is a special provision. In case of intermediary, what the government is or the provision says is the place of supply shall be the location of the intermediary itself. So that means if the intermediary is located in Bangalore and providing the service to customers across globe, still the place of supply will be Bangalore only and his income shall be subjected to GST. So that is the provision. Now what had happened is this the intermediary definition is interpreted by the tax authorities very widely. The word starts with an agent or broker or any other person. This is the words used for the intermediary. But the department is taking a view that any word comes as marketing or support services, it is viewed that it amounts to intermediary. These provisions were there even under service tax, wherein lot of notices have been issued, and this issue is continuing even after GST also. Recently the department has come out with a circular in July 2019. As per the circular, what they are saying is, if supplier of back-end service is located in India and does arrangement for supply of goods or service or both to its client's customer, for such supplies the supplier will become intermediary of such supplies, as the services are merely for arranging or facilitating the supply of goods or services or both between two or more persons. Now they are going to the extent of bringing the back office support also within the scope of the intermediary. Now in the same clarification, they have also told that if the back office support is done on his own account, it will not amount to intermediary. Now the another point what I would like to mention here is, now when we say back office support, what are all the things that they are saying that it is taxable? Like they are saying that supply chain management services and the processing of the POs and the invoices and the customer orders, or maybe any these kind of services, they are saying it comes under the intermediary. Now what we feel is that every such kind of back office support may not qualify as intermediary, because I have also mentioned that one of the recent tribunal decision, that is Verizon India Private Limited, in the case of the Delhi tribunal, it held that the words used is an agent or broker or any other person who is facilitating the supply of goods or service between two or more persons. So what is held is that if the contract or the arrangement is on principal to principal basis, then such contract may not fall under the intermediary service. So merely because somebody is doing a back office support or marketing support, it may not come under the intermediary. If somebody is working on a cost plus mode, when we say that arranging or facilitating, there should be a three parties involved. And whenever that supply happens by one person to another, the mediator should be arranging it. If it is only a two-way contract, wherein the person in India is maybe doing some marketing survey and he is looking at the marketing activity, but he is not really involved in going to the end buyer and negotiating the price or coordinating for the supply, if he is not doing such kind of activities, then definitely he would not come within the scope of intermediary. But as far as the department goes, they would cover everything that is worded as marketing and try to bring it under the intermediary concept. Now, another confusing issue that has come up is in case of resident welfare association, where the contribution per month exceeds ₹7,500, whether GST is payable on entire amount or only on the amount that is in excess of 7,500. Is it on the entire amount or only on the excess amount?
Entire amount.
Entire amount. Now, if you look at the entry, what is mentioned in the exemption notification is up to ₹7,500 per month is exempt from the tax. So now, whether up to an amount of 7,500 would mean that the amount in excess of 7,500 is only taxable, or the moment it exceeds, entire amount is taxable.
Exceeds.
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 On the excess amount or on the entire amount? If we generally look at it, the moment the word used up to means, up to that amount it is always exempt. Whatever is in excess, that only will be liable. That is what is our plain reading of English. Now what the circular is clarifying is, the moment it crosses 7,500, entire amount is taxable. Of course, maybe many people in the industry following the same method because nobody wants to get into litigation. But if we really read it, up to means up to is a cutoff. Only the excessive amount is liable for tax. So that is another confusion that is created by this circular. The circular is issued again in July 2019. Now the next question is, what are the implications on recovery from employees towards food transport etc? Now firstly, whether it is taxable or not. Anything recovered from employees towards food, canteen supply and then transport facility, is it taxable or not? Now, I would tell that recently, just this week, one of our client base was surveyed by the tax authorities, and they are asking for payment of free snacks given to the employees in the evening. Now here I am talking about amount recovered. If we look at the provisions, employer and employee are related persons. That is as per section 15 of the GST Act. Now as per entry 2 in the schedule 1, any transaction between related persons is considered as deemed supply even though there is no consideration. If we go by these provisions, now anything, maybe what the tax authorities are saying in the survey might be correct. Now whether that will sustain or not, that is something which is different. But if we look at a plain reading of the provisions, this might be correct. Now considering that, what in my view is that wherever there is a recovery, there is certainly a risk. Now in some places, even under the VAT also, on the canteen recovery taxes were paid. Now if you look at the GST period, wherever there is a recovery, there would be a tax implication for sure. Now what is the tax implication? Now here, if you look at it, rate of tax for the canteen facility, there is a 5% rate of tax that is applicable. Initially it was 18%, but afterwards it is amended and all canteen supplies shall be liable for 5%. That is without input tax credit. Similarly, for the transport facility, there is two rate of tax. One is 5%, another one is 12%. 5% without input tax credit, 12% with input tax credit. Now, what happens is whenever the amount is recovered, the company will have to pay applicable taxes. Now, if the company is paying 5% tax, what happens? Now, 5% tax comes with a condition that input tax credit shall not be taken. But as a company, if you look at it, there could be several input tax credit which could be partly attributable to this activity also. Now, like if we are going and doing the statutory audit, we cannot say that we have not verified the employee recoveries. So then what happens is, by virtue of section 17 and this explanation given to this rate of tax notification, and then section 17 and rule 42-43, there will be a requirement to reverse portion of the common credit. This amount may not be considerable, but still it is a compliance which might come up. Similarly, in case of transport facility also, if 5% tax is paid, there could be requirement of reversal of import tax credit. And also another issue that would come up is the valuation. Now, because employer and employee are related parties, whatever amount recovered, is it sufficient if tax is paid only on the amount recovered? It would be again get into litigation, and the department may say that it should be on the market value. So one can look at paying the tax fully on the market value, so that if he wants to avoid any litigation. Otherwise, if there is a sure case of litigation, when we say market value, one can look at, you know, considering the cost itself as a market value and then pay applicable taxes.
So what if notice paid recovered from the employer at the time of resignation?
Yes, sir.
Sir, GST is applicable.
Sir, coming to the notice pay, again it is a very, you know, ambiguous point whether the tax will applicable or not. See, going by the department's view, it is taxable. So everywhere, wherever they are going for the audit or assessment or anything, if there is a notice pay, they are asking for the payment of tax. But if we one really looks at it, is it a service provided by the employer to the employee? Now, employee is doing, you know, part of his employment contract, he is working. The employment contract says that he has to serve certain notice period, and if he is not serving it, then he will have to give up certain amount as a notice period recovery. It is like, I have paid salary for over the years. Now, I am expecting you to work for 2 months after giving the notice. And if you don't give, the part of the salary which you have already earned, you give it back. So that way also we could interpret. But the thing is that as of now, what it stands today, no ruling or no clarification has come in favor that it is not taxable. And the amounts are so small that one may not be, you know, willing to go into litigation and fight to the extent of tribunal or the level beyond. So currently the practice is that everybody is paying it.
Because it is a notice pay ranges from 3 to 5 lakhs, even it goes to 10 lakhs also.
Correct, sir, but the amount of tax on that is 18%.
10 lakh into 18% is
1.8 lakh. But still, if you look at the cost of litigation to get favorable order for that 1.8 lakhs, that would be more than that, because the department is of the view that it is taxable. So therefore, definitely in the first or second level, you will not get relief. The matter will have to go up to tribunal level. So your cost of litigation, everything will be more than that amount. Considering this, many companies are paying it. It is not that it is conclusively taxable. It is something which is in dispute.
It's not a declared service.
Sir, the declared service under service tax, or if you take it under GST, it says that agreeing to the obligation to do an act or to refrain from an act or to tolerate an act, like that it uses the word. Now, one could also say that the company is tolerating the act of employee leaving without serving notice period. That is why this is taxable. That is the interpretation. Now, whether that is really right or not, that is something we have to dispute it and see.
Notice pay is generally defined as a payment amount of salary.
It is computed based on the salary pay.
So, it may not be a consideration for a service or.
Sir, it may not be a consideration, but the thing is that now the tax authorities are taking a view that it is consideration. Now either we have to agree to their view or we have to fight for them.
But they are telling to pay and protest it.
Yeah.
If some ruling is there, we will return back.
Correct. They are doing that. Now the next issue is, now let us take, there is a partnership firm. Maybe a CA in practice only, he has got a partnership firm. He has got a building also, own building. Now he has given that building for use by the partnership firm. And there is no consideration charge for that. It is a free usage. Now whether or that free usage GST is applicable? Yes or no? Now firstly, whether partner and firm are one and the same or different persons for GST? Different persons. Because if you go and see the definition of person, individual is separate and the firm is separate. Now the next question is whether partner and firm is related person? Related person. So now, just before we saw the clause entry 2 in the schedule 1. So any service, even without consideration, between related persons is a supply. So now is it a supply or not? So it could lead to levy of tax. Now the next question is, what would be the valuation issue? Should it be market value or should it, can it be any value?
Sir, this is not falling under section 7.1, no?
Which one, sir?
This provision of facility of office to the firm of a partner,
sir,
where he is not charging anything,
sir,
it is not in the course of business. The partner,
sir,
who has permitted his office to be used, he is not doing it in the course of business. He is not in the business of renting.
Sir.
Gratis he has allowed. Because of that, it will not fall under section 7.1 of the CGST Act.
Sir, the definition of business, even if it is done without any profit motive or anything, like it is like any individual giving a commercial building for rent. So any individual giving commercial building for rent, it is not his business in the sense, in the true sense if you look at it, but it is an activity which is attracts tax.
Here, it is a free supply by the partner to the firm.
Yes, sir.
So it may not come under 7.1. Even it may not come under the definition of business, you can take your view.
And partner, if it is not required, he is not crossing limit of 20 lakhs. His receipts.
That is a separate thing.
Yeah.
See, if his receipts, now if you value this supply and afterwards valuing it, if it does not cross 20 lakhs, then it will be exemption. That is no issue. Now if it crosses 20 lakhs, then there will be a risk.
Reverse charge
would not apply. Sir.
The partner has to
partner pay. Will have to get registered.
Registered and
paid. Now the thing is, sir, if it is a firm's income is entirely taxable, then there is one proviso in the rule 28 which says that whatever value you decide and raise the invoice, that could be the market value. But the thing is that now you take a case of a advocate firm. Advocate's entire income is out of GST, so exempt income for him. So now then what happens? So then he might have to value it at a market value. It is something which we have to explore it in detail and see whether any alternative way is there, like sir told it is not in the course of business, something like that we have to evaluate. But otherwise, if a tax officer looks at it, definitely yeah, there could be a case of litigation. Now similarly, the another one issue that is there is the services between branch and head office. Now this is again, many of you may be aware, this Columbia Asia advance ruling. Now again, in this case also, whether should we value our services and do the billing between branch office and head office and the other way round, or can we take a shelter saying that it is not taxable? Whenever we do the stock transfer of goods, we are clear, we are paying the taxes. If that is the case, then why not for services? As far as the service between head office and branch goes, still there is a lot of confusion and there is no clarity. If one wants to be very safe and you know very conservative in his approach, then we can look at raising the invoices from head office to branches and then paying the applicable taxes and taking the credit. The risk could be more if there are any exempt incomes either in the head office or in branches. If the full input tax credit is available everywhere, then there may not be any serious implication. But if there are fully exempt activities, then that could be a serious issue. Now the next question is whether input tax credit can be availed on the prepaid expenses. Yes or no? Now, what is generally the prepaid expenses?
Insurance.
How? Why do we account it as prepaid expense?
Paid in advance.
Paid in advance.
The benefit of it.
As per section 16.2, the credit is available when the goods or services are received by the recipient. Now the words received, does it mean that the services should be consumed also, or if the receipt is sufficient? If you receive an invoice for AMC, comprehensive AMC for full year, or maybe a software license is bought which has a validity of 1 year, the moment the license or the access is given, he would raise tax invoice and you would account it. Maybe for the purpose of accounting, you might classify it as a prepaid expenses. Now whether credit can be taken on receipt of the invoice or not?
It should be consumed.
It should be?
Consumed.
See, in my view, the what section 16.2 says is that the service should be received. The moment you get an invoice and you have given the access to that whatever the software license or the AMC starts, your receipt has happened. You have the right over that. Only thing is that you are getting consumed it over a period of time. The law does not say that you should consume it. Now, if you look at it even for the capital goods also, you should receive it. You might not use it, you might not install it, you might keep it, but still you are eligible for the input tax credit. Similarly, in case of services also, if the tax invoice is given and the access to that service is received, the credit should be allowed. Only the restriction is if he has also treated it as advance and he has given only the received voucher but not the tax invoice. In such case, yes, there is no eligibility for credit. Otherwise, we feel that the credit should be allowed.
For insurance?
So, insurance is also similar. The insurance also, the period of that coverage may be 1 year or maybe different period. But the moment you pay the premium and you get the tax invoice, the right or that receipt has happened.
But the department is telling you take a proportionate. They are not telling you to avail it in the
year. Sir, there is no provision which says that the credit should be taken proportionate over a period in which the service is consumed.
Sir, your view is correct because there is no condition similar to receipt of goods. In case of goods, there is a specific condition where you are receiving goods in installments. On the receipt of last installment, you have to avail the credit. There is no analogous condition for services. His view is correct. You can defend. You are right.
What is that, sir? Definitely would come, sir. So many people will have different view. That too with the tax authorities, definitely they will go with the revenue pro view. But mind you, we can defend it.
What about the lease rentals?
Lease rentals, sir?
Lease rentals, like for 3 years you have a lease rent that you pay. And how am I going to use it? On the rate of invoice, I will use it.
So the lease rental, what happens is if the lease rent is paid in advance,
Now we also have to look at the agreement, whether it amounts to a continuous supply services or it is a direct one time service. Now what happens the moment is continuous supply service, so each installment is a service provided received. So then there will be tax invoice and you are eligible to take the credit on receipt of the tax invoice. So that is how it goes. Next question is, what is the time limit to avail the credit that is paid on the reverse charge basis? Now in case of reverse charge, how do we avail the credit? When we are eligible to avail credit and what is the time limit? In service tax, what was the mode of availment? We should have paid the tax, we should have had the chalan. Next month it was always on payment. So now in GST how it works?
If it was RCM is discharged before 30th of the end of the month, you can avail in the same month.
See now if you look at the provisions, the RCM credit under GST is availed based on the self-invoice. That is given in Rule 36. If you look at the documents based on which input tax credit can be availed, one of the document is the self-invoice that is generated by the recipient of service for the purpose of this reverse charge cases, wherever the suppliers are not registered. Now that invoice should be raised at the time of receipt of goods or service. The moment I receive a service from a case where there is a reverse charge, the invoice should be raised. Now the document is self-invoice and you are raising it as soon as you receive the service. So that means you have the invoice with you, you have received the service. That means the credit can be taken as soon as there is a self-invoice. But what it says is it is subject to the payment of tax. That means you can pay the tax in the subsequent period. It is not that you should pay the tax under reverse charge in order to avail the credit. You can generate a self-invoice, you can avail the credit. But that credit becomes valid and it is not reversible so long as you pay the taxes. If you delay it, there will be interest. But the credit is available. Now, what happens if you, there is a time limit for availing the credit, right? Section 16, subsection 4 says that credit shall be availed not later than the filing of the return under section 39 for the period of September of the following year, or filing of the annual return, whichever is earlier. So now in this case what happens? Now if you pay reverse charge tax, maybe so for the 17-18, now you are paying in this month, whether eligible or not. Self-invoice should have been generated in 17-18 only, not now. We will just see that in the next one. Now this is a case of a normal input tax credit also. The same question. Now there is one invoice which is raised in 17-18. Now it has come for accounting. Whether are we eligible for the input tax credit or not? You all might be aware that as per the press release issued by the and the provisions made by the government, the credit for 17-18 could have been taken up to March 2019. But there is one issue. The provision used in section 16.4 is that the credit shall be availed before filing this returns under section 39 for the month of September for the following year, or by filing the annual return, whichever is earlier. Now you might be aware that the return under section 39, that is GSTR 3, is deferred. The due date is not notified. Now the annual return due date is, right now it is 31st August. So then what is the time limit? Return under section 39, that is GSTR 3, is deferred. That means the due date is not at all there for that. Annual return due date is 31st August 2019. So if we go by the reading of these provisions, one can still avail the credit now also. This has also been held in the case of AAP and Co. by Gujarat High Court.
That may be the reason why GSTR 1 amendment is still happening. the system is permitting.
Yes, sir.
For 1780, the system is permitting amendment of GSTR 1
yes,
of 1780 E1 now.
Yes,
this
sir.
May be the reason, because they cannot prevent that. If they prevent, they will be going against the High Court decision. It will be a very serious issue.
Yes,
that
sir.
May be the reason.
May be the reason.
The thing is that government is not accepting that there is a, this is a due date like that.
But they should have stopped it. The system should have prevented amendment of 1780 GSTR 1. But the system is accepting still.
If we go by the press release, it should have stopped in the March itself.
But it has not stopped.
No, sir. Now the next question is, whether is there any impact under GST if the company or the assessee is engaged in the mutual funds or security sales. Now we might have come across with many companies who park their excess funds in the mutual funds or some shares or things like that. So will it have any impact on the company on the earnings from that? Whether it is the income is liable for GST in the first place? No. Securities are neither goods nor services. So whatever income generated out of the sale of such securities is not subject to tax. But there is another one issue here. Now if you look at the section 17 subsection 3, it says that any transaction in securities is considered as exempt supplies. The moment that a transaction is exempt supply, what happens is whatever the common credit taken will have to be reversed proportionately. So that means if a company has got income from mutual funds sales, then they have to take 1% of the sale value as exempt income or from sale of shares, and that has to be taken for the reversal under rule 42-43, because there would be certainly some common credit, maybe the rent, building rent, or this the audit fees, like some admin expenses. So there will be common credits. Now if you go by these provisions, wherever there is a securities related transaction, the input tax credit have to be reversed. Now next one is whether the input tax credit can be taken on the services related to motor vehicles. Yes or no? There is a purchase of motor vehicle, there could be servicing or repair of motor vehicles, there could be insurance on motor vehicles. Eligible or ineligible? Now there is two provisions here. One is before 1st February 2019 and the second one is after 1st February 2019. Now there is an amendment has taken place to the definition of through the provision of blocked credit. Now before February 2019, purchase of motor vehicles, any motor vehicle, was not eligible for input tax credit. Now after 1st February 2019, if a motor vehicle purchased is having a passenger carrying capacity in excess of 13 persons, then that is eligible. Like for a company, if they buy bus, it is eligible for input tax credit. Whereas if they buy car, it is not eligible for input tax credit. Coming to the other services like renting, hire, insurance, all those things. Before 1-2019, the restriction was on the renting, that is hire charges, cab hire charges or bus hire charges or anything for that matter, any hire charges was ineligible. But there was no specific mention about the ineligibility on the repairs or insurance. So if one takes an aggressive view saying that whatever motor vehicle repair is there or the insurance is there, this is for my business, still he might be eligible to take the input tax credit before 1-2019. But after 1st February 2019, what the amendment says is that the insurance, hire or repair services are eligible only for the cases where the capacity of the motor vehicle is in excess of 13 persons. Like for example, there is a manufacturing company which is hiring the transports for employees. If what they have hired is bus,
they could be eligible to take the credit. But if they have hired car, then they are not eligible for taking the input tax credit. Clear? Now next one is whether input tax credit available on the construction of building which is given on rent. Eligible or not? Now here also, if you look at the provisions of section 17.5, there are two exclusion entries. One is the works contract service. So long as it is for the construction of an immobile property which is not sold, then works contract service is ineligible. Similarly, any goods or services purchased for construction, repair, renovation or any alteration other than plant and machinery for use by that particular person in the course or furtherance of business, again that is ineligible. But there is a High Court ruling from the Orissa in the case of Safari Retreats Private Limited. There it is held that even if a construction activity is done for a building which is given on rent, the credit should be allowed. So we have to see that how the other courts or other people view this decision. But if we go by the decision, the credit can be available. But it still could be subject to litigation.
Is it restricted only for the renting, or can we use this judgment for the purpose of for when the building is for manufacturing, factories, offices?
Sir, if we read that decision has specifically mentioned that since they are going to let it out.
No, they said that I'm letting out. Okay, then for that purpose they said that. Now, so that is his business. My business is
manufacturing. In the decision only, the court made a point saying that they are letting it out. So therefore it is eligible because it is a value added method of taxation. That is what they have linked it. And they have said that since there will be output tax on the income, the input tax is eligible. So it is not that for their specific business activity it is told. It is because they are going to let it out that they are told that it is eligible.
So renting of buildings, hotels, you feel we can go with this?
Huh. We can go on this decision.
But the one difficulty what we have is, unlike CBDT, there is no practice of giving a statement whether they accept the decision or they don't go by it. We are not aware whether this has been appealed to, the department has gone before the Supreme Court. There is no such.
No, we don't.
There is no info on that, and this amount will be very huge. Correct. Very risky proposition.
Yes, sir. That's why I told it would be subject to huge litigation.
What you are doing, Raya? Tell me. So that's what I am telling.
Same.
So you are availing.
No, we are same. Same.
No, that's what I am telling. You are availing credit now.
Going depends upon this one. Risk.
Risk appetite.
Risk appetite on the risk. Then not only the rent, even for the factory also. Because there is a specific question was that I am using it for the purpose of further earning rent on the GST pay. Then why not? Then I am putting on factory.
Not allowing on factory, you are again discriminatory.
Everything.
Because this decision is based on Article 14, unfair discrimination. We can take the help of that very decision and avail for factory.
Factory, everything. Office building also.
Yes.
Because by using office building, we are earning some whatever the taxable income.
Sir, what is your view on the construction, on the builder, when they construct the property, and this ITC setup, are they compelled to pass on the ITC? What I'm saying is, apartment construction. Yes, sir. So while constructing, they will have to input. Yes, sir. Okay. While selling, output is there. Correct. And those who are booked during GST period only, means before the OC.
Yes, sir.
So which is like the builder offsets in his returns.
Yes, sir.
So is he liable to pass on the benefit to the consumer or not?
Sir, generally, if we look at the way the builders would have structured his price, he would have definitely factored that he will get input tax credit. So when he is factored his costing and based on that he has decided his price, then it is already passed on.
No, he is not passing on. See, passing on is, he says that, for example, if it is 2 crore property, he says you pay 24 lakhs as a GST.
Correct.
I will be charging you 2 crore 24 lakhs. 2 crore plus 24 lakhs separate.
Yes, sir.
GST invoice issues.
Sir, there is a difference between the passing on the benefit of input tax credit and what is collection done from
the... What repeatedly heard in the TV and all.
Yes, sir.
I have even a video.
Yes, sir.
Which says that GST input has to be passed on. Suppose he gets the input credit like on marble, cement, these are all, which comes around, for example, 18 lakhs.
Yes, sir.
So he has to charge, this is my view, like 24 minus 18. So which is like 6 lakhs. He can say 2 lakh plus 6,000 you pay.
Sir, it does not work like, sir, it does not work like that, sir. Now, if you look at the way, if one has to be done like that, then every industry it has to be like that.
Not only. Every industry, because government has repeatedly put the clause saying that home buyers are eligible for the.
Sir, now, sir, the
and what every is other industry, as you said, every other industry it is taken care internally.
So no, sir, one second.
That what is he saying about that? This pre-GST, whatever the benefits of that excise and CST or those benefits are there, that has to be passed on. After the GST, it's already inbuilt. It's already you've not considered
so
GST.
Then
the
charge 2 crore plus 24 lakhs.
Yeah, sir, how it works is, sir, now 2 crore is the basic price. Now 24 lakhs is the tax. Now if you look at it, now what we have to see is that while deciding that 2 crores, how he has considered his input tax credit. Whether he has taken, no, one second sir. Now whether he has taken that in 18 lakhs of tax as his cost only, or he has excluded from the cost. The moment he has excluded it from his cost, what he is loading to you is without GST only. When he collects 24 lakhs, he would have already paid 18 lakhs to the suppliers. He will pay differential 6 lakhs only to the government.
Only 1 year. Again, why 5% is given? 5% or 1 year?
Yes, sir.
Because they were not passing on this input credit.
Sir, that may be the government's policy. Now, when you are in the regular scheme, that is when you are in the full rate scheme, all we can look at is, and if somebody wants to say that anti-profiteering happening, then only then one can look at is whether he has added that input tax element of GST to the cost or he is shown as receivable. So long as he is shown it as receivable, he is passing the benefit to you. If he had loaded to his cost, then the 2 crore would have become 2 crore 10 lakhs. Then on that there would have been GST. He is not doing that. So that means he is passing the benefit to you. In any case, in the value-added tax chain, it works in the same manner only. From the end customer is the person who has to pay full tax to the person who is selling. But if you look at it, he would have passed on the benefit. Otherwise, that amount what you have to pay to the seller would be much higher.
Sir, the video what the peer on the other side is referring may be specific to the contracts which are entered pre-GST and prices were recalibrated post GST. That is specific to that.
Yes.
Recomputation of the price.
So there it has to happen.
There, what is the total tax impact and what is the tax impact in the new regime?
Yes.
That is how they will compare in the decisions on anti-profiteering. That is the methodology adopted.
So
that is not in general.
But that
you agree with that?
Yes. That's what I told. It's only for the pre-GST period.
Yes.
Not
it is.
Now what they did actually, they said this is the cost. And then what was the applicable tax at the time of payment or limit. This is where it comes. They already, costing is done. Then the GST came in case of Prestige, because I have a property, they are passing on the credit. But
all pre-GST contracts, yes, there is a requirement.
Yes.
But if it is an entirely post-GST contract, then it would depend. It would depend upon how we structure.
Project which has come in post-GST, yes.
Yes. But again, passing on credit has a lot of issues.
Yes.
How far they
will if issue is there, sir, yes. Many a time what happens now? As a chartered accountant, if it tells the builder you have to pay, he will pay.
Then never give the costing anyway. Yeah. Input, how I know?
Yes,
how
much costing is something that one can tell this is a
cost. They make more money rather than give the credit.
If it's my money, I will keep it.
Yeah. Anyway. Yes.
Next question, what I have put is whether the capital goods credit and transition credit, one can go and claim it as a refund from the government in case of exporters. So we are seeing in many companies there is a transition credit and they are purchasing so many capital goods. Whether is there any mode in which they can go and claim the refund of it?
Yes,
In case of refund, there are two methods of claiming the refund. One is refund of the accumulated credit where export is done under the LUT. The another one is export on payment of IGST and then claiming the refund. So if one is following the method of claiming the refund of accumulated input tax credit, in such case the refund on the transaction credit or on the capital goods credit is not allowed. The refund is allowed only to the extent of the credit that is availed in a particular tax period for which refund is applied. If one is going for the refund of payment of IGST and then claiming the refund, in such case he can use the capital goods credit or even the transition credit and then he can encash it. In case of on payment of IGST, the thing is that one should have sufficient credit to pay on the export invoices for that particular tax period. If it is there, one can go for this method and claim the refund. Whether interest is payable on the net liability or gross liability in case of delayed payment of tax. This is something which we are coming across in many cases. So whether it is on the gross or on the net. Gross or net? Now if we look at it, how the tax payment happens in GST. The tax payment happens from the debiting to the cash ledger or credit ledger. Only when the amount goes from cash ledger and credit ledger, then the payment of tax happens. So long as the amount is remaining in the cash ledger or credit ledger, it is your asset. Government has not received anything. The interest is for the delayed payment of tax. Now if we go by this understanding, then even the amount is there in the credit ledger, it is the tax is not paid. Only when the amount is debited from the credit ledger, then the tax payment happens. So if we go by this understanding, then the interest is payable on the gross only. There is one High Court decision also on that, which says that interest is payable on the gross. But now government has come out with an amendment. This year budget they have proposed an amendment to section 50, wherein they are saying is that the interest is payable only to the extent of the amount debited from the cash ledger. Whatever is debited from the credit ledger, even if there is a delay, there is no interest. But of course there is one rider. If any return is filed after initiating any notice under section 73 or 74, then interest has to be paid even if the payment is made through credit ledger.
You cannot file the return without payment of the tax.
Next is whether interest is applicable on the reversal of the transaction credit without utilization. Now there could be many cases where the transaction credit would have been taken and would have been reversed wrongly. Like many places the credit of cess was taken, and then department came and told cess is not eligible, and the cess would have been reversed also without utilization. So whether interest is payable for that or not. In our view, if the utilization has not happened, then there is no need to pay interest for this reversal, because there is no specific provision for that, and also it is a transition credit. There is one High Court ruling also which says that in case of credit availed but not utilized, interest is not applicable. This is in the case of Commercial Steel Engineering Corporation. Next one is whether GST audit applicable for GSTN where turnover does not exceed 2 crores but at a PAN level it exceeds 2 crores. If you take PAN number or your turnover as per financials, it is in excess of 2 crores, but if you look at each individual GST number, it is not crossing 2 crores. Is the audit applicable for each GSTN or not? Audit is applicable because it is based on the aggregate turnover at PAN level. So even if there is a nil turnover case also, if the all India turnover exceeds, then it is applicable.
Yes, sir. Exempt supplies. Yes. Now, another question is, what are the points to be taken care of filing ITR for individual? This is one point which I put because recently we are seeing that so many individuals IT returns are filing. But there are a lot of GST issues that are coming up with the ITR. Now, like for example, there may be a person who is having so many incomes. But what happens is, for the purpose of GST, he would have given one income, or he would not have taken the GST registration at all because he is not aware. Some of the cases what we are seeing is that, like, individual providing services to a customer who is outside Karnataka, he may think that my turnover is not crossing 20 lakhs, so I am not liable. But if you look at the GST provisions, if somebody is doing interstate supplies, then the basic exemption limit is not applicable. So then what happens is the entire income becomes taxable. So this is one point which we have to consider while evaluating somebody's income.
Sir, again, income. Suppose if there is a consignment agent.
Yes, sir.
What happens is they will sell the goods, but for income tax purpose, consignment commission is only the income.
Yes, sir.
It is, there is no goods and sales. There is a clarity given by CBDT and FAQ also. So now one side will declare that GST, this thing, sales is something like 10 crore.
Yes,
but here, not even 10 crore, maybe 8 crores. Here it is like 48 lakhs or something like that, commission. So on commission, presumptive income will come also.
Yes, sir.
So presumptive income basis will go. So this mismatch will throw error for the department.
Right, so that definitely will
go and error. Explain it.
So then we will have to go and explain it.
There is no other option.
No other option. So there are different cases which would throw error between when we compare the income tax return and the GST return.
Yeah.
Different cases that would throw error.
And these
so
are
cases we will have to go and explain.
Yeah, genuine reasons.
But the thing is that when we are doing it from our end, certain income tax returns or financials, anything, if we come across with certain scenarios, then it would be better that if we highlight now itself, because afterwards if the department comes and raises the demand for a small person, it would create a lot of liability. Now another thing is that exporters, if there is any service provider, individual or a small organization, if he has an export income, then he will have to take GST registration, so he might not be aware of it. So that one thing we will have to look at it. And another thing is that exemption of 40 lakhs, that is applicable if only one is exclusively engaged in the supply of goods. Somebody is engaged in the service activity, then 20 lakhs only is the limit.
20 lakhs is the service
tax. Yes. And another one point is that while computing this 20 lakhs turnover also, we have to include all exempt incomes also. Like, there could be many persons who is having FD interest itself is running into lakhs, and they may be having some small taxable income. So then they will come into the bracket of the 20 lakhs, or they may be having residential house rental income. That also will be added for the purpose of 20 lakhs. So these things also one has to keep it in mind. Next one is whether electricity and water reimbursement claimed from the tenants should be subjected to GST or not. We all know that in case of renting activity, so the landlord will claim the reimbursement of the electricity charges and water charges also on month-on-month basis. That would be at actual levels. Or maybe he may be having a diesel from that also, and whatever BESCOM electricity, and then water. But all would be on an actual basis. So whether it is subjected to GST or not.
Both these are exempt. Both these are rules. They are exempt under notification.
Yes, sir.
Electricity is also goods. Water is also goods.
Correct.
Both are exempt.
Yes, sir.
But for input tax computation, we will have to take that as an exempt turnover. These are not nil rated.
Okay.
Only services are nil rated.
Yes, sir.
Goods are always exempt.
Yes, sir.
So the rules refer to the exempt. So these are all exempt, not liable for tax.
Okay.
Provided we are recovering these amounts separately.
Okay.
Whether by means of a separate invoice, supplementary invoice, or a debit card.
Okay. Sir, one point I would like to mention, yes, of course, there is, as I mentioned, there are two views. One view is what you have told, the same view.
There is another view which is coming up is that what the view is that it is considered as a composite supply. And once it is a composite supply, what happens is what is your principal supply? Now if you look at logically, no one would come and occupy a premises only for buying electricity. He would come for an activity of taking the building on rent. These are all the ancillary things that are coming up for the activity of renting of the building. So going by that logic, the department may still say that even the electricity, water are subject to GST as a composite supply.
I think we can take a stand.
Yes, sir.
What can be naturally bundled?
Yes, sir.
May not be always naturally bundled.
Okay.
Law doesn't provide me separate building for what can be built as a composite supply. There is no bar in law for separate building of those supplies which can be naturally bundled.
Yes,
there is no bar.
Correct.
So that can come to our help.
Yes, sir. We are as of now we are saying that it is not taxable, but what we are happening is in the industry, if we look at it, many big technology parks are taking a view that it is all taxable. So what happens is when somebody goes in that line, the department also will start saying that everything is taxable. When everybody is paying, why you are not paying? So that is something which issue is.
Tax planning angle.
Yes, sir.
For example, tenants are paying the electricity end of the day. If they pay directly to the electricity department, that doesn't come into the GST purview at all.
Sir, what happens is in case of many companies, the electricity meter will be one.
No, no, 1 meter only. I'm saying 1 meter also. See, normally in rental agreement it is defined.
Mm.
Even if I say apartment owners association also, there it is defined. Everybody has to share in this ratio. Karke. So that share ratio, if they deposit it directly, there is no collection at all happening. See, when GST officer is asking, because collection is happening at a central pool.
Okay.
Now central pool is not happening, he cannot assess all the people also.
But practically the people prefer that
rule. No, no, if there is something like 50 people, 100 people, they can agree and do it.
Yeah. Wherever there is no payment to the landlord, yes, there is no issue.
Yeah.
The issue comes up only when he claims it as a reimbursement.
Yes, yes, yes. But this way, totally avoid it.
Yes, sir. Another issue, this is partly related to service tax because of the recent decision I thought I will put it. Whether segment rate to be reversed on the completion of real estate projects of the unsold portion. Whether reversal of the credit is required or not. Generally, everybody was of the understanding that whenever there is a completion of a unit project happens, whatever to the extent of the unsold area, whatever credit taken, that has to be reversed. Recently there is one High Court decision has come in the case of Steno Limited, wherein the High Court said that the eligibility or otherwise of a credit should be determined at the time of the availment of the credit, and any event that is happening subsequently cannot make that credit ineligible. So if we go by this ruling, so one need not reverse the credit whatever taken on the completion of a project. Now whether this ruling would be appealed to Supreme Court or what will happen on this, that is something which we have to wait and see.
In the new regime,
yes, sir,
the change of user comes. In VAT regime we used to reverse.
Correct.
On flats that are completed but not sold.
Yes, sir.
I think GST also we have to follow the same thing, safer. Otherwise,
yeah, safer approach is that only. General understanding was that only. Now this the court ruling has come. So somebody might explore and see.
We have to see the facts, situation of the case.
Yes, sir. Now another issue, JDA entered prior to GST. So what is the tax implication on this? This is again the in view of the one recent advance ruling that has come in the case of Durga Projects and Infrastructure Private Limited. Now whether GST is payable or service tax is payable, which is the tax payable? In case of JDA that is entered prior to GST on the landowner portion. Now if you look at the service tax authority's viewpoint, what they are saying is that as soon as the sharing agreement is entered, service tax in respect of the landowner portion is payable. And accordingly so many demand notices have been issued. Whether that same thing will sustain or not is a different story. The service tax view is that it is payable at the time of sharing agreement. Now this advance ruling what has told is, to the extent of work done up to June 30th, service tax is payable. And whatever work that has happened post GST implementation, GST is payable. Now this advance ruling is contradictory to what service tax authorities are saying. And as far as the VAT was concerned, there was no tax on the landowner portion before GST.
Here, landowner portion, landlord buys the invoice on the...
No, sir, the builder, what construction he is doing and handing over the built-up area to the landowner,
yeah,
on that.
Yeah, that's what. Then the invoice has to come from the landowner to the builder.
No, no, no. Builder will raise it on the landowner. Because he is the one who is building for that property.
Correct.
Yes. So the next one is whether the charitable trust is completely out of GST or do they have any GST liability. If the charitable trust, let us say, has got so many income, they are running maybe a hospital or maybe education institutions, so many activities they might be doing. Whether they might even sell some books also, they might sell some CDs also. So many activities they might do. Whether entire thing is out of GST or how it is.
To the extent of, suppose they are sponsoring the sports event.
Yes, sir.
Sale of tickets, it's taxable. So you need a charitable trust.
So what we have to see is what are all their activities that amounts to charitable activities as defined in the exemption notification. To that extent only the exemption is available. If some there is a charitable trust which has a building which is given on rent, that definitely will come under the supply as per the GST. Now if they have any sale of some CDs or some other than books, because printed materials there is no tax. If there is other than books, if they sell any assets or anything, so again, they will come within the bracket of GST. Notice period recovery. Now we discussed on the notice period recovery. Now another recovery, like there is a joining bonus given. Now if an employee is joining, then he will be given a joining bonus. And he is required to continue work for at least 1 year. Now if he leaves within that 1 year period, the joining bonus will be recovered. Now what happens to this recovery? Whether it is still taxable, similar to notice period, or can we take a different stand?
Similar to notice period. Contract of employment, the receipts from the contract of employment, it is exempted.
Yes, sir.
Not taxable. Taking that, there should not be tax on the any kind of receipts or receipts. They can give backs.
Yes,
for
sir.
The contractual employment should not be under GST.
Yes, sir. In my view, this joining bonus is may not be on par with notice period recovery also, because it is at the time of joining we have given him some advance salary on the understanding that he will work for so many period. If he is not working for that much period and he is going away, then whatever the advance salary paid, that will be recovered. So in my view, that would not attract any tax.
Low risk.
Yes. Whether reversal of input tax credit is required on the provision created for the non-moving or slow-moving of inventory.
Yes, logically yes.
Yes, sir.
Provision no, on write-off yes.
Yes. So there is a difference between the provisions that was there under the SENVAC credit rules and what is there in the GST provisions. In the SENVAC credit rules, it was provided that even if the provision is created, then there was a requirement to reverse the input tax credit. Where if we come to GST, it is specifically given that only in cases where goods are lost, destroyed, or theft happens, then there is a need to reverse it. Or if there is a write-off happens, then there is a need to reverse the input tax credit. If only the provision is created, but no credit is, no stock is written off, then in such cases, there is no need to reverse the input tax credit. If the common office is used by the group companies, whether cross charging is required? We saw for the firm and the partner case. So now this is a case where the group companies are occupying a common office. Is it required to cross charge between the entities? In my view, it is required. Is there any GST impact on the creditor's write back? Because this is one miscellaneous income which we generally see in many companies, creditors return back. Whether it will attract any GST or it will have any GST impact. See, one impact what it could have is, now if there is any input tax credit that was taken in respect of the purchase from those creditors, because there is a requirement to make the payment within 180 days. So now that if the creditor balance itself is written off and no payment is made, then whatever the credit availed, that will have to be reversed. Otherwise, as such, there is no impact.
Even
sir, there is a difference when we
service is already rendered, client is not paying.
Yes, sir.
In spite of allow, client closes his shop also.
Sir, if you look at the provisions of section 34, what it says when credit note can be given, it says that whenever there is a value that is charged in excess, or there is a dispute in the services, or there is a tax that is charged in excess, in those cases we can issue a credit note. In case of bad debts, what happens is the service is provided, the value of service there is no dispute, and the service what is provided for that also there may not be any dispute. The just the thing is that the other party is not paying it. In such case, it will not fit into the provisions of section 34.
When you are working for client as well as government,
yes, sir. Or you have to ask whether client can say that the service is not sufficient.
Actually, now the new government needs to be pushed by fraternity like us as well as trade committee.
Yes, sir.
See, what is going to happen is next they are going to introduce through the invoice through the GST portal.
Yes, sir.
Which I only advocated from the beginning, sent many representations to the PM office and all. So that litigation has to come down.
Yes, sir.
But once it happens, they will make sure that you pay the GST.
Yes, sir.
But where is the guarantee for the collection? And government cannot say that even after 90 days.
Yes, sir.
I have paid your GST also and you are not facilitating for the collection, which is absolutely wrong. They cannot make a laborious process of the collection, which is like police case, you can put 420, go to the court, 3 years. Then collect the GST also like that.
That you are not representing.
No, I am representing.
Only GST requirement, whatever the collection.
No, even that also I will represent. No hesitation. The reason is, one good thing is, Modi's app is there, PM app. If you give anything, there is a response.
LD limit. That is also subject to GST. Liquidated damages.
Yes, sir.
Suppose delay in service.
Yes, sir.
For that recover some penalty.
Yes, sir.
That is subject to GST.
Yes, sir. That is subject.
So we have to give a self invoice.
Yes. Give us if we are recovering the amount, then we have to raise the tax invoice with GST. If we are paying it, then we can ask the party to give our tax invoice and we can avail it.
So he is getting benefit again.
Yes.
That is a double.
No,
because the supplier has delayed it.
Correct.
On the top of it, I am paying to the government and passing on the credit to him.
Yes. See, supplier has delayed it. Then, yeah, he will raise the invoice and he will avail the credit. See, the government is collecting the tax and that is availed as input tax credit.
That is not under section 17. It is not a prohibition. So, eligible.
See, another thing is that we can also look at it saying that if you delay in supply, the value of the supply itself will be reduced. Instead of saying that there will be damages, you can also look at saying that if you supply after a certain period of time, then the value of supply would be reduced. In such case, then you can give the revised, you can give a credit note and reduce the value of supply also.
credit note cannot be given by the recipient. Credit note cannot be given by the recipient.
Recipient cannot do it. Then the other party should agree. If not, then you have liquidated damages with tax, it has to be.
Still the supplier can take the credit. Yeah. If at all, raise an invoice, pay tax to the government.
Yes. Because it is in the course of business, business activity. Whether ITC available on the goods that is given on replacement, warranty replacement. What about if the goods are given on goodwill warranty? Now the difference between the warranty replacement and goodwill warranty is that warranty replacement is covered in the warranty terms. If it is a goodwill warranty, it's actually there is no terms that is covering the warranty periods. As in a goodwill understanding between the supplier and the recipient, this replacement of items are given free of cost. So now what happens? In my view, in case of warranty replacement, which is agreed in the terms of the agreement or the purchase order of the order, there is no need to reverse any input tax credit on the items that is given free of cost. But if it is given as a goodwill warranty, wherein it is not clearly agreed that we will be giving warranty replacement, then it will be considered as given free of cost. So then whatever input tax credit taken on that, the credit has to be reversed. These are all the few questions which I had listed. So if you have any questions or anything, that we can address it.
There are sometimes some vendors who have risk, huge risk appetite. They collect the GST from the customers and don't deposit it, don't find the GST or do it.
Yes, sir.
Because they are doing the collection, they think that it is my money.
Yes, sir.
So there actually, now what is your suggestion? Because one, my client, what I have done is like a huge amount was involved, 21 lakh. I said file it with the anti-evasion wing. And given the details all saying that this is the client, this is the amount evasion is happening, and GST or 2A is not reflected in the this thing.
Yes, sir.
So what do you suggest? Any other way?
That we have not recommended for somebody to go and file in the anti-evasion.
No, my client only, I told in their name. They will get the award as well as...
So what we are looking at is the recovering the amount from him if he is continuing the supplies in the further period also.
No,
so
what? One supply happened.
One supply happened.
Value not is 2 crore. Value not is 2 crore.
If the party comes to know that you are informed anti-evasion, what will happen?
Nothing, I will tell you, so far 1 and 2 years over.
Sir, you told you have given some representation to PM's office and all. Please give a representation and continuously at that under for 16-2C. 16-2C is the most draconian provision. This is the same thing what you are now talking. I do not think there is any other commonwealth country where similar condition is there for a receiver of supply to ensure that the supplier pays the tax to the government.
Because input tax credit...
The entire wherewithal, government machinery is with them.
Yes.
How will that a receiver of supplier of goods or services can ensure that that fellow pays the tax for me to allow credit? No, I tell you one practical example. I purchased 5 laptops 6 months back. That fellow has not at all paid. Now what I have to do, as per you, I have to go to anti-evasion.
Yes. Because otherwise you are using the input credit. See, you may be affordable.
Difficult.
But for my client, it is like 20 lakhs is nothing but their earnings for the entire year. They are losing the ITC.
Sir, Gunda Gavastare, sir.
No, that's Vishay Bera.
Okay,
sir. Right. Can you elaborate on the exemption?
They are not charging any GST on that. Is there any exemption that warranty supply, because it is a sale value zero, GST need not be paid?
Sir, in case of warranty supplies, what happens is,
the price, whatever the warranty period is there, during that whatever replacement they do, the supplier would have factored that in his original sale value itself. So long as that is within the warranty period, anything is given free. It is presumed that the value for that is already built and the tax in respect of that is already paid to the government. Because of that thought, there is no need to charge tax again whenever there is a replacement given under the warranty period. If something is given out of the warranty period as a free of cost, then it would amount like a case where there is the, for that particular item there is no tax paid to the government. So then there is a requirement to reverse the credit.
So, but warranty, it comes from a warranty pool. I mean, it doesn't, there is no correlation between one to one.
Yes, sir.
So, even if I own up the warranty after the warranty period, it comes from the same warranty pool. It doesn't come from cost.
Sir, what happens is within the warranty period, when you look at it, there will be a reasonable amount of whatever the replacements the supplier would have imagined and you would have factored. Okay, this much might come. Okay, there might be cases where something more come, or there might be a case nothing might come. So, but the understanding is that to the extent that is covered within the warranty period, everything is already the billed and the taxes are paid. So therefore there is no tax again. This is the understanding. There is one clarification also very important.
Sir,
whether
all vegetables based on GST persons are liable to file annual return.
Sir, all registered persons liable to tax, sir.
There is no exemption.
No exemption. All regular registered persons.
It is 2 crores. But in clear tax, they have mentioned that, however, the following are not required to file the GST F9. Taxpayers are composition scheme, casual tax persons, and the persons paying TDS.
Sir, there is a different type of registration. If you are registered as a regular taxpayer, all regular taxpayers are required to file annual return. If somebody is registered as a composition taxpayer, then there is an annual return is required in form 9A. Like if you take other people, a casual taxable person, the registration itself is taken for a shorter period. And as soon as his activity is over, he needs to file a final return and surrender it. So for them there is exclusion. If you ask whether all registered persons are required, it would depend upon the nature of registration. Like input service distributor, he is not required to file annual return. Any other questions?
So interest income, it is exempted.
Yes, sir.
Exempted, sir.
Yes, sir.
And you have to reverse ITC also.
So in case of interest earned out of giving any deposits or loans, then there is no requirement to reverse input tax, except for the banks.
FD interest in the companies.
FD interest, if it is earned. There is no tax on that and there is no need to reverse the input tax credit also. There is exclusion in that for that. Any other queries?
Then you need to declare in the GST here?
Exempt income. Yes, sir.
Interest.
Interest has to be disclosed. Bank
is an exempt income, you can disclose. If you don't disclose, it will only be a disclosure error. There will not be any tax increase. Exempt income, there is a place and you can disclose.
No, tax implication or penalty implication may be there. Suppose now you have 2 crores FD interest itself and your hardly rental income is only 2 lakhs. So by not disclosing, you are only declaring 2 lakhs. By disclosing that your income, now you will be liable to file your 9C also. So,
audit.
Yeah. Audit. 9C will come.
9C, payment of tax on rental income of 2 lakhs. Yeah, how will follow?
2 lakhs and 2 crores. So 2 crores, 2 lakhs. 9C is applicable. And fees will be there.
But ITC reversal not. ITC reversal.
ITC reversal will not.
Just like NDT. They have paid the amount, I think. Bank loan. But I understand from top view, not the bottom view. They have paid the amount. They have not disclosed certain things. That is where they are hunted. Not allowed to fly.
Renting of residential units by the company to its staff members at subsidized rate.
Yes, sir.
Now GST is applicable or
no? Sir, if it is a residential accommodation, it can be rented by any person to any person. So long as it is a residential unit used as residence, it is out of GST. But the thing is that it becomes an exempt income in the hands of the company, so there will be a ITC reversal.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We have come to an end of an interesting and interactive session on GST question and answer. I thank Vinayak Hegde for his excellent presentation and sharing his knowledge. May I request Manju Devan to present a memento to the speaker as a token of respect and gratitude.